Abram's honor, But the truth is, brothers and sisters, Abram disguised the truth of his reality in order to protect himself, and while protecting himself, to his family and future heirs. Last week we talked about Abram following God so that he could go from leading a good life to leading a godly life. For most of us, that journey is a process. Not really for most of us, for all of us. That journey is a process. Most liars don't just stop lying, cold turkey. You don't go from being the greatest liar in the world one minute to telling nothing but the truth the next. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
Whatever your truth is, whatever your favorite sin is, whatever your favorite journey is, you don't just stop cold turkey from living that kind of life, being accustomed to it, for having that as a default to trusting God completely. It takes time to dismiss who we were and become what God called us to be, renewed. Y'all remember the Apostle Paul? When I would do good, what did he say? Evil is always present. It's right there for us to take if we want to. Abram started well. The text says Abram left what he knew and followed God to the land of promise. After arriving there, he traveled throughout the land, seeing all that it had to offer. He noticed the land's richness and all its vast resources. Perhaps he climbed Mount Carmel, looked over the valley of Megiddo and its richest, rich farmland. At this time, the farmer was the thing to do. And how the mountain itself provided natural military advantage for both defense and offense. Perhaps he noticed the fresh waters of the Sea of Galilee, the mighty Jordan River, the Valley of Sharon, Cana of Galilee, and Capernaum. The text says that after he saw the land, the Lord said, "To your offspring, Abram, I will give this land." Abram's response to God's promise was to worship God. You know why he worshiped God? He saw the magnitude of what God was giving him. How the Lord was increasing his possessions and power. God's promises were more than he could imagine. And seeing the promise for the first time really caused him to be in awe of what God was going to do for him. Amen. Y'all ever wanted something?
Yeah.
Right? You ever believed that you were going to get it? But then there was this moment of anticipation before you got it?
Yeah.
I don't know if y'all like me, but sometimes if even I've been promising, I believe I'm going to get somebody promise. I wonder if it's really going to happen. Right? I wonder if it's really going to be as good as I think it's going to be. And then when I get it and it exceeds my expectation, I'm just completely amazed that what I have is really as good as I want it to be. That's really where Abram was. But then in the middle of all of that, being hopeful, being thankful, worshiping God because he was going to get the view of his promise from God was clouded by problems. The text says, then there was a famine in the land. According to Webster's, famine is an acute and general shortage of food. Google says it's an extreme scarcity of food. So we're not talking about not being able to eat steak and lobster and whatever else you want to throw on your plate. Any kind of food, there was just an extreme scarcity in the sense of the text. Is a sudden extreme scarcity of food. Imagine if your refrigerator was packed with everything that you wanted. You got up in the morning and there was nothing in it.
Yeah.
Then you went to the grocery store and the shelves were empty. Then you decided to try to walk across town. There was nothing there either. Then you decided, I don't know nothing about going in the fields and looking for corn and all that stuff, but let me try. And that was gone as well. Everywhere they looked, there was just a scarcity, a shortage of basic provisions. So they temporarily left the land of promise to find provision. Egypt was close, so they went to Egypt to find food until the famine was over. When he got close to Egypt, Abram got scared. Tell your neighbor, it's normal for us to get scared when we face crisis. It's normal. When you're facing a real crisis, now I'm not talking about them fake made up crisis, but when you're facing a real crisis, it's normal to be afraid. Because if you got the answer to what you're facing, it's not a crisis. If you got money in the bank to pay your bill, it's not a crisis, right? If you know how to navigate your way from where you are to where you need to be, it's not a crisis. But a crisis is when you face a moment and you don't know how you're going to get through. When you're facing an illness and you don't have the money to go to the doctor, or even if you do have the money to go to the doctor does not know what to do for what you got going on. Amen? When your children are in trouble and you don't know how to help them, that's a crisis. When the world is in such turmoil that you don't know how to get through and put it back on its right course, you're facing crisis. It's normal when facing crisis to get scared. Crisis knocks us off balance, and at times opens us to unanticipated responses to uncertainty. One reason we have emergency drills is to prepare before an emergency happens, so that we don't have to think about what to do when they do happen. Yeah. I mean, that's really the reason that we practice, so that we'll know how to respond in the midst of the anxiety that we feel when an emergency hits. We're already there. People practice fire drills, storm drills, active shooter drills, baby drills. When fear hits us, when we're in crisis, our natural response is to be faithless. If we have not trained ourselves, practice our emergency drills, we won't trust that God is an ever-present help in time of trouble. We won't trust Him unless we practice it. We won't understand that God will provide a way of escape when life and the devil try to trap us. We won't know that when we get pressed, God will not allow us or life to crush us. That when we get persecuted, He'll never abandon us. We will not live in the reality that God with us is more than the world against us, unless we practice our faith, unless we reminded ourselves of who God is and how God responds when we're facing uncertainty. Yes, yes, yes. So when Abram was about to enter Egypt, he stopped thinking about the bounty of food and started thinking about the potential of problems. Yeah. Have you ever been at the edge of accomplishment and then talk yourself out of what you needed to do to experience that accomplishment?
Yeah. Yes.
You've been right there?
Yeah.
And you start thinking about all of the bad things that could happen, that might happen, and talk yourself right out of the pathway to accomplishment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen to what Abram says. The Egyptians will kill me if they know you're my wife. Who is Abram thinking about? Himself. His safety. He told his queen to say she was his sister. Why? So they would treat him well for her sake. So they would spare his life because of her. Nowhere in Abram's calculation did Abram think about the risk he was exposing his queen to. Listen, by his own account, Abram knew that the Egyptians would be romantically attracted to his wife. By his own account, he knew the Egyptians would pay him to spend time with her. By his own account, he was turning his queen into a courtesan. He was turning his wife into a, well, I shouldn't say the word, did I get it? Prostitute. Yes, ma'am, Miss Masha. Yes, he was. He absolutely was. And reckless, you can add to that. So what happened? When he got to Egypt, the Egyptians saw that she was very beautiful. Pharaoh's officials told him that Sarai was somebody he might want to take a look at. Pharaoh took a look and said, I think I like. Do you think Abram tried to protect his wife?
No.
Figure out some reason why Pharaoh could not take her at that moment? Though Abram went right along with things without interruption. He had prepared Sarai to cooperate with Pharaoh for his own protection. So Abram prostituted his wife for his protection, more provisions, his own comfort. Pharaoh said that he took Sarai to be his wife because Abram lied about who she was. Abram thought about himself, but never thought about the risk he was exposing his wife to. Sometimes, brothers and sisters, in our effort to get ahead, our effort to secure our own safety, we forget about the cost we require us to pay for our progress. Whatever you think about the whole lion situation, here's the cost Abram was asking Sarai to pay. He was asking her to betray their sacred marital vows. He was asking her to betray godly principles. He was asking her to betray her own sense of morality and submit herself to unwanted advances. Abram was pimping out his wife.
Amen.
He had no godly thought about how his decision would impact their future in faith. So you ask, did he get paid?
Yes.
Text says Abram acquired sheep. What were they paying him for? That Abram was had acquired cattle, male and female donkeys, men servants, maid servants, and camels. Tell your neighbor, he got paid. But she got played. Amen. I don't know what she had to go through fully. But Abram put her life and their life in jeopardy. I don't know what happened. But I know Sarai was sent uncovered, unprotected, inexcusably into a task to save her husband. What did happen and what could have happened, brothers and sisters? What could have happened? Because Pharaoh thought Sarai was his wife. Certainly, at a minimum, she was under mental and extreme duress because she was in an unsafe place. And all because Abram turned his wife into a courtesan for his benefit without thought of what would happen to her. As Christians, brothers and sisters, there are just some lines we should not cross.
That's right.
We should not ask anyone else to cross the line. You know, sometimes we think we are right because we don't cross them. We can get other folks to cross them for us. But that's not okay either. It's not all right. We should never expose our spouse, our loved ones, anybody within our sphere to physical, spiritual, mental, or moral harm just because we get in a jam. We ought to love God and love our loved ones so much that we believe that God will get us through no matter how much our backs are against the wall. That he is able to keep us. That he has not brought us this far to leave us. That he never requires sin in order for us to be saved. There's some values that ought to be permanently etched into our DNA. Some principles that just are non-negotiable, no matter the situation. We have to work on our spiritual emergency drills so we won't think we need to revert back to who we used to be in order to get through what we're facing right now.
Amen.
Y'all remember these phrases that we got? That we tell ourselves as if it's a safe measure. Y'all hold it, men, brothers and sisters. I need to come down off the wall for just a minute so I can tell you, I can get you straight. Right? Right? God understands me. He understands my heart. He's going to forgive me for what I'm getting ready to do. And when we tell ourselves all of those things to give us an out when our back gets against the wall. That's not an out, brothers and sisters. That's the lie we're telling ourselves. Amen? That's the sin that we're opening ourselves up to when we do not trust God. We need to rehearse who God is in every situation, in every moment. Not just when things are good, but when things are bad. just by your own ingenuity that you got that?
No.
That you was really that smart? To be able to navigate yourself through all those pitfalls in life? That it was by, you know, how you thought about getting ahead that you were such a hard worker that you got to where you were? Or for those of you who are married, that you are the one who developed your relationship to where it is right now, and it was all because you were a good husband or a good wife, and you were the one who navigates your way through your problems. You need to stop telling the lie for a minute. And tell yourself the truth that by God's grace. You are. Every person has run into somebody who did not care how good you were. They were going to get after you anyway.
That's right.
There were traps laid for you that God either got you over, took you around, protected you in the middle of it. It is not hard to see the blessings and grace of an almighty God.
That's right.
Practice our emergency drills. Remind ourselves that is not by our goodness, it's not by our greatness, but it's about the greatness and love of an almighty and eternal God that we've gotten where we are. Work on our faith to be able to stand in the presence and arms of God. Stand in righteousness, stand in truth, stand in faith, knowing that it is God that is bringing us through. But brothers and sisters, the great beauty in this story is that even when we fail, God is faithful.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Don't lie to yourself that you're so good that you've avoided all the pitfalls and you're so much better than everybody else. Tell yourself the truth that you made some mistakes that should have cost you your life. You made some mistakes that should have cost you your job. You made some mistakes that should have cost you your family. You made some mistakes that should have caused others to not want anything else to do for you. To anyone else to be with you, to do anything with you. But God was there to rescue you.
Yeah.
Truth about Abram and us, brothers and sisters, is that sometimes we go back to our old ways.
Yeah.
Sometimes we forget about our faith and try to trick our way to success. But in Abram's life and in our own, God is right in our situation. He's intervening. He's working for our good. Romans said God works all things together for our good. So when Abram was risking his future, his family, and his faith, when Sarai was exposed to danger and dishonor, all because Abram decided that God was not enough, God was right there turning his foolishness into fortune. Even though Sarai was in Pharaoh's harem, God was her shield and her protector. So the Lord inflicted disease on Pharaoh and on his entire household. Just look at the harm Abram's foolishness caused harmless people. He went to Egypt because they had food and he didn't have none. They had what he needed. And look at what he cost them. All because of his own foolishness. Others, brothers and sisters, frequently get caught up in our failures. Y'all know that? Look around your own lives for a minute. See how many people have been caught up in your foolishness. How many people that have gotten caught in the traps that you laid all because you didn't trust. People frequently get caught up in our failures. They get caught up in our sin. They get caught up in our lack of trust. But God still keeps us. He still turns it for our good. God kept her. The Lord kept them. And he keeps us. But brothers and sisters, we need to pay attention when God saves us from ourselves. We need to learn to trust him and believe that he will provide. So the next time we face some foolishness, we'll trust God than trust ourselves. Listen, if God can save us when we put ourselves in danger, don't you think he can save you before you get to danger? Don't you think he can guide you through and has the power to protect you before you put somebody else's life in jeopardy? Don't you think it's just as easy for God to give you faith as it is to protect you when you throw yourself into a mess? We need to learn that we have a God who is able. We don't need to use deception to protect ourselves. All we need to do is trust in a God who is able to keep us.
Amen.
The psalmist says, many are the troubles of the righteous, but God has delivered, y'all know what tense that word is? Past tense. He has delivered us from them all. Whatever you're facing right now, brothers and sisters, whatever is in your way right now, whatever pitfall is before you, whatever obstacle is in your way, rather than trying to connive your way through it, we need to trust God's ability to navigate us through and us to be protected and blessed because of his goodness. We need to trust God's leadership rather than requiring him to rescue us all the time. Next time, brothers and sisters, when you get to your next time, you know, God that got you out of that pitfall, next time, before you get there, you need to ask God, Lord, what is it that you want me to do? How do you want me to respond in this situation? How can I keep from reverting back to what I knew? And trust you instead. Somebody asked me to get some examples, helpful examples of spiritual emergency drills before I conclude. Some helpful examples of spiritual emergency drills. So you know the purpose of an emergency drill is when you don't have a real emergency, right? You practice for when an emergency comes. So before we get in a spot where we need a job, we need to practice praying for a job. Right? Amen. Practice praying. And one way you practice praying for a job, God, what kind of job do you want me to get? Right? And then start looking for God's answers, both through how God responds to us and how God has responded to other folks. Who of you have ever prayed for a job? Y'all looking around? So whoever sent me that note need to be looking right now. Whoever sent me to know, look around at all the hands that are. Here's a way to practice for an emergency drill. Go to those people and talk to them. How did you pray for God to direct you? How did you know it was God that was talking to you? How do you face situations on that job with God in mind when you get in trouble? And start practicing those things before you get them. For those of you who are in school right now, when you get ready to go for a test, just like you're going to pray for a job one day, pray before you get to your test. Amen.
Amen.
Don't just pray 5 minutes before you get in the test. For those of you who know you work on a job, you actually also study something about the job, right? To put yourself in the best position, but then also open your arms to give God an opportunity to work in. It's about thinking about potential situations that you're going to face before you get to them. It doesn't mean that there's going to be a fire because you practice a fire drill. But if one comes, you know where your exit is. It doesn't mean that you're going to have a hard time getting a job before you get a job. But if you do, you will have already practiced. How many resumes do I need to send? How many people do I need to talk to about how I get connected to this job? Right? How many people do I need to build a relationship about how to do the job with? It's about the practice. Just like you practice for anything else, you can practice for God to answer your prayer and respond to your prayer, respond to your situation when you need it. Right? And there are moments right now in your life that you can begin doing it before you get to an emergency. Just practice praying all the time, searching for God, listening for God. And then when you need God, you won't have to figure out whether it's God talking to you or, as I said in Sunday school this morning, or whether it's that food that you ate getting the dessert just right. You can be able to discern which voice is speaking to you. Amen?
Amen.
Now, if you need more, my phone number is 612-965-0309. That's my real phone number. If you need more, come talk to me.
Amen.
Amen. Y'all gonna send me a note, I get to talk to you. There are ways that we can practice our faith, and this whole point of this is before we get to the tough moments of our life, we've actually showed up. We've practiced our faith by praying regularly, by reading our Bible regularly, by fellowshipping with other Christians regularly, by getting somebody else's advice who's been where you're trying to go and following it. Y'all heard that last part, right?
Amen.
Regularly. And if you're trying to figure out how to get through a tough marital situation, don't go talk to somebody that's been divorced 5 times. Right? Don't talk to somebody who's in the same hole you in. Go talk to the person who's been in the hole and they out of it.
That's
right. Right? Amen. Somebody maybe who's been where you are 5 times and they've successfully gotten through with God. All of that is a part of practicing, a part of learning, a part of understanding how we get to where God needs us to be. Talk to some of those people you saw hands raised, right? Understand how God speaks to them and to us in the middle of our crisis. And when we're able to stand with brothers and sisters, brothers, we can see God clearer. We know we got Him. I don't care what nobody tells you. Doing life by yourself is not a good way to go. Figuring out everything on your own is a recipe for failure. Thinking that you need to rescue yourself when you can't breathe or walk is stupid. Smartest thing you can do when you need help. Y'all know the smartest thing you can do when you need help? Help me, please! And then wait.